To go with our wire, we need some wire cutters. So the piece of wire you're going to need is around about 4 inches long. Let's get rid of that one. And then just to turn the shape, we're going to need some little nose pliers, and all we're going to do is create a loop like that. Now, if you're using a wooden skewer, obviously you're not going to be able to create a loop, but what you can do then is glue your foil. So we're going to put some foil onto this. Okay, so piece of foil, what is it? Probably 8 inches by 10 inches. It doesn't have to be too precise. This is just going to pad and fill the core of your elf head. So what you're going to do is gently just get it into a kind of round shape, and then you're going to insert your hook into the cavity of the foil. Then you are gently, without too much force, going to gradually push the foil into a kind of egg shape. Now, this doesn't have to be completely accurate, but what you want to avoid is getting pits like that, or getting sharp sticky out bits. And so if you just do it very gently, just adding a little bit more pressure at a time, you'll find the foil will collapse in on itself quite nicely. And as we do that, because we've created a hook for our wire, this foil will fill the hook and it will give it security. Now you see I've got a nice little hole there. We want to avoid having holes because they trap air. And we're going to cover this in polymer clay. Anything you use polymer clay for has to be baked to make it hard. And in the baking process, any air which is trapped inside, which this would create here, swells obviously with the heat, and then it can bloom your piece. So you end up with little bubbles where air has been trapped inside, expanded and tried to escape. So we want to avoid any holes as much as is humanly possible. If we have some, and what I've started to do is create a little escape route for them anyway. So there's the foil, nice and compacted, and you'll get to a point where you can't press anymore. So we can see we've got quite a nice egg shape. I'm not worried about a head shape at the minute, just keep with the egg. And what we're going to do now is, using the back of a spoon, we're just going to make sure there's no sharp pieces sticking out that we can't see. It's my phone pinging away in the background. Whilst we're on this lockdown, I don't know about you, but I've been on my phone so much, I've actually got neck ache. So that's not good, is it? I'll have to get my headphones out. Okay, so you can see by using the spoon, you just start to create a flatter surface. I don't know if you can see that. And it's pretty secure. There's a little wobble in there, but it's not too bad. Great, so once we have our foil, we then need to look at putting our clay on and shaping it. So the tools you'll need, let me show you the proper sculpting tools, if you like, and then I'll show you the shortcuts if you don't want to spend a lot of money. So these are my favorites. We've got a ball tool. You can pick all of these up pretty cheaply online nowadays. It's got a smaller ball one end, slightly larger ball the other, and that's really good for little curvy bits, blending. I've got a flat tool. So I'm showing you that to exaggerate it, but actually the one that I use when I'm flattening clay is this curvy one. Now the purpose of a flat tool is to push the clay. It's not spreading it. We can't spread it like butter. This is about pushing it. And so having a nice flat surface allows you to push it evenly without creating marks in it. And then we have a rubber tip silicone tip, and this is for smoothing clay, where your fingers are really the best tools to use, but like I've got fingers like sausages, where you can't get into little corners, you use something like this. So this substitutes your fingers and your thumb. So substitutes. If you haven't got anything like this, which most people wouldn't if you're not into it, you can use the tip of a paintbrush, or you can use this is a cable needle for knitting. This is what I started off with, and I created my own little handle for it. But you know, mums, grannies, aunts, uncles, anybody who likes their knitting may have something like that for you, or the tip of a paintbrush. Okay, so that's that one. For a pushing flat base tool, well, I looked in my cupboard, and the spoon I've just used, the tip of it is perfect. So that gives you a nice flat surface that you can push the clay in. That works perfectly well, and you wouldn't have to spend a fortune. So that's that one. And for the ball tool, now this is a bit tricky because it's nice having a ball tool because it's soft, but the purpose of it is to get into little areas and create little indents. So although I haven't got one on me now, you can use something like a darning needle. That would work. You know, if you had a bit of wire and if you actually sanded that off, you could probably use the tip of something like that as well. A ball tool is quite specialised. They're not overly expensive. So if you enjoy this tutorial and you want to have a real go, then it might be worth actually splashing out and getting some. Okay, so now we're going to cover this in our clay, and I'm using Living Doll clay. The Sculpey Living Doll comes in different tones, so you can see I've got two here, and that's paler than that one. They do different skin tones. You can use any polymer clay really. Fimo do little packets, so if you just want to have a clay without spending a lot of money, I think the small Fimo packs from Hobbycraft are somewhere around £3-4. A block of the Sculpey costs anywhere between £12-14, depending where you get it from and what skin tone. Sometimes there's a slight difference there. Okay, so we're going to break a bit off our block. Make sure your hands are clean. Anything, any residue, or any, we should all have clean hands at the moment anyway, shouldn't we? But any residues on your hands that you're not even aware of will come out onto your clay, and then you end up with dirty clay. When you do clay work, make sure you're not wearing anything fibrous like a woolly jumper or anything like that. The fibres float in the air and you'll find that they'll get wrapped up in your clay and they spoil your work. So I'm currently wearing a linen top. So anything like a cotton or a linen would work perfectly. So to condition your clay, what you're doing is you're warming it up and you're stretching it out, and we're making sure there's no air bubbles in there. You can see before it gets warm, it starts to crack, and we don't want that when we're modelling. So what we're trying to do now is use the heat in our hands and friction to warm up the oils in the clay, so they become nice and supple and pliable. Now you can see I've got dirt in here. What looked grey is dirt coming off. And that's probably because I've been messing with the aluminium and aluminium foil. So as that oxidises, is it oxidises? Or anyway, it reacts and you end up with grey powder. Okay, so we'll just try and avoid that, because that will trap in lots of air. So try and squidge it all in. Okay, so this is a bit boring for you to watch. And then once it's softened, you should be able to spread it with your fingers quite easy like this. So I don't need to roll it. All I'm doing is creating a patty. And this is going to be somewhere around 3 to 4 millimeters thick. Okay, once you've got it, and you see I've got a little bit of dirt in there, but that's going to be at the back. So take your foil, decide which is the back of your head. So for this one, we can see, I can almost see a face shape, a chin, going into the back of the head, the occipital here. So I'm going to choose that as the back, so I'll turn that. But then I've got a challenge because we've got that little hole, and so potentially if that blooms, that's going to bloom on my face. So before I do anything else, I'm just going to pack that little hole, and then we'll leave a vent for somewhere else for the air to expire. Now, when you put the clay on your foil, we are pressing it. We're not trying to spread it. We are just pressing it down and working it out. And what we want to do is avoid air bubbles. So we start off at the front and we're gradually pushing it backwards, making sure it stays in really close contact with the foil, so there's no air bubbles. And then we'll turn it over and just encourage it all the way around, like so. Oh, I'm beeping like a good man, aren't I? Okay. And then, once we get there, take your time on this bit because it's so easy. I get so impatient. I really like making my faces and doing this, I get. So I'm pushing all of this now up to the top of the head. So closing it up, making sure there are no little gaps left underneath the surface as best as I can tell. Bringing it all together, smoothing it. There we go. And then we're just going to pinch all of that in, and we're going to take off the excess, like so. Now you can pinch it off and obviously get a ratty edge, or you can use a little blade, which I had around here a minute ago. Where's that gone? Oh, can't find it. So let's just tear this off. There we go. Just make sure that all of that joins up. Now, because potentially you're going to put hair on your model, I mean, you may not, you may want it to be a bald man. But I don't worry too much about what's going to be on underneath the hair. Now, because I feel potentially I'm going to get a bloom with this one, I'm just going to leave that hole at the top. And so any air that expands that can't find a way out will hopefully push its way up to that weakest point, and that will escape from there. Now you can see from where I've covered it, it's lumpy and bumpy and horrible, so just put it in the palms of your hands and just as best you can treat it like you would if you were rolling out a ball of clay in your hands, and you'll find it will just smooth over. So I can almost see there's a bit of a jawline, isn't there, sort of forming. You see, and that's the top of the head. And the neck. Now for now, actually, we don't need this, so I'm going to pull this off because that can affect how you, what you decide to do. Let's take that off. There we go. And the reason why we've got such a long piece of wire is because we can use the wire to hold, to turn, as we're shaping and building our face. Okay, so the next thing we're going to do is we're going to mark out where our features are going to be. So we're going to draw a line up the centre, and then we're going to decide what's about halfway, and we're going to mark that across like that. And this is where our eyes are going to be. And just so we keep that in mind, I'm just going to make two little indents there for our eyes. Then between the eye line and the jaw line, halfway is going to be where we're going to place our nose, and then between the nose and the jawline, halfway is where we're going to have our mouth. Okay, so hopefully you can see you've got your line for your eyes, line for your nose, line for your mouth, and that's going to be our basic guide. Okay, so I'm just going to bring over this box. You might recognise it as an old Ferrero Rocher tin. And I'm just going to push that on there so I've got two hands free for a minute. So the first thing we're going to do is create the brow. And this is to, what we're doing, rather than trying to make features out of what we've got, we're going to build the face on top of this layer. So we'll see very little of what's here at the moment. So the brow is going to be a strip that goes across here, and you'll see it'll give a cavity for the eyes. Okay, so we make a nice rectangle, just flatten it out a little bit, keep it as even as you can because we want to keep the face symmetrical, and then we're going to place that just above the eyes, like so. Okay, and what we're going to do is just use our thumb just to press it on. Flatten it in a little bit so you can see now it's just not protruding quite so much, and we're going to blend all of these, the side edges and the top edges, in with our thumb. So with that, I'm literally just pulling it over, and you can see it's very, if it's warm, it's lovely to work with, it just very naturally comes in. Now you'll notice I'm a nail biter, which makes my hands look very ugly. But I have to say, for this process, I did grow my nails once and it didn't work. Not for me anyway. So if you're going to use your fingers, then you can't have, well, so you can't have, I'm sure there are people who manage quite happily with long nails, or you're going to rely on your tools a bit more. Okay. So there's our brow, and you can see my vent hole has disappeared. So let's just get that back in. And we're not going to worry about these little divots at the moment, okay? So there's our first feature on our face. And then what we're going to do is we're just going to disappear the join line. So whereas we've smoothed this out really quite over a far distance, here we're not going to. So we're going to take our flat tool and we're just going to push that edge in just so it adheres to the clay. So let me show you using a spoon, because I haven't got the spoon just for show. It will work just as well. So you can see it just takes out that line. Okay, so that now is nicely in. And wherever you've used a tool, if you then go over with your finger, you should get rid of any harsh lines or marks. So there's our brow on. The next thing we're going to do is add a nose. Now I'm doing a characterful face here to exaggerate the features, but if you want to do a really pretty face, like a very delicate fairy, the process is exactly the same, but the shape of everything is going to be slightly more refined, slightly smaller. The curves will be less exaggerated, they'll be softer. Whenever you're creating anything, it's always good to have some visual references, so some pictures or a photograph, or I quite often go on to Google and I really want to get to be able to do expressions well. So at the minute I'm always putting in sad man, happy old lady, and then you can see how the faces move, you know, with different expressions, whether they're happy, smiley, sad, whatever. So I've just made a teardrop and I've just pinched the bottom of it, and that now we're going to place that on our guideline like so. And then I'm just going to squish that on. And I really am not too worried. I don't want to squish it too much because I don't want to lose the shape. But I'm not too worried at the minute whether it looks good. All I want to do is get it in place and just blend that in. Now I'm using this tool because this is one of my favourite tools. This is where your cable needle comes in. So you can use something like that, you see, to roll it in, and you can keep a nice straight line as you're doing it. And that equates to me using this one. There we go. Now this is a different face to the one that I've already made and baked, which is going to form the back end of the lesson. This is one that I did on Facebook Live, which has baked. But obviously Facebook Live, I won't be able to edit that in with what I'm going to do now to show how to paint this one. So I'm starting the lesson, almost going backwards. So this is just to show you how I got to that stage with that face, really. Okay, so I've got quite a noggin on there. I'm quite happy with that. Again, the bigger they are, the more characterful they get. So we've got the brow, we've got the nose. The next thing we're going to do is the top lip. So again, we're going to just take a tiny bit of clay. Now how much clay you take, there is a little bit of practice with it, but you'll know if it's too much because it will drown out the rest of the features. And that's why I start with the brow, because if I start with the brow, which is the biggest piece, and then you come down to the nose, then the lip is going to be even smaller. So I just find that I naturally get the right amount of clay. But I don't know if that's a, you know, what we'd all do, or whether it's just something that I do, I don't know. So what you want is a small rectangular piece which is going to sit under here, and we're just going to flatten in that top line which is going to sit under the nose, and we're going to literally push that up under the nose. And then we're just going to curve it onto the face. And you see, I'm just using my thumb just to blend it on, just to make sure it fixes on. If you look from the profile, that's what it looks like. Not very sexy at the minute. And just blending those two bits in. We're going to be adding on top of this, so I'm not too worried, but I don't want to have a line that's not been attached to the clay. I'm also not going to worry about refining the features at this point. All I want to do is just get the clay on in place. So proportionately, I'm happy with everything. Okay, and then the last bit is to put the bottom lip and chin on. So we're going to do a rectangle again. Let's take a bit off. Perhaps slightly more sort of square. And the bottom lip is narrower than the top lip. So where we did the rectangle that way, this time we're going to do it sort of vertically. And then we place that underneath. And you can see it's got a bottom lip. So again, we're just going to blend that on. Like so. And as I said on my Facebook Live, I am getting to the point where I know that I want to do a young girl, or I want to do an old woman, or, but when I'm just messing around like this, I just tend to let the face appear and see what I think it looks like. Does it look male? Does it look female? Does it look old? And really, I just then follow the clay and see what the clay is doing. So what we're going to do next is we're going to add on cheeks. So if I wanted to keep this like a young, thin boy, which is what I'm seeing in this at the moment. Don't know if you can see that. Then I probably wouldn't put much in the way of cheeks on. I'd just build it out a little bit. If I want this to look a bit more characterful, then I'm going to put cheeks on. So I'm going to do just that. Whenever you're doing anything which is two, so two cheeks, two ears, two eyes, you always use one piece of clay and then do it as best you can in half to get it as even as you can. So I'm going to break that in two and then just twiddle those ends, so we've got sort of two pear droppy kind of shapes. They've got a bit of a twist on because I'm trying to do this one-handed. Okay, so we're just gonna flatten them down a little bit. They are a bit on the long side, so we'll see what sort of face that gives us, like so. And what we're going to do is we're going to place the point sort of under where the eye is going to be, along the crease of the nose, and we're going to end level with the mouth. And don't worry too much about this, because we are going to move it and shake it around a little bit. And then we're just going to gently start to press it on, keeping the nose and the eye cavities. And we're going to come round the side, and I'm just going to start to soften that out and underneath. And as you're doing this, you want to try to make sure you're not flattening any of your other features that you've created, your nose or... Okay, so we can see our face, whoops, is beginning to build quite nicely. Now I can see that this is coming into the chin. So if he was looking down, I'd keep the wire here, because it that's where his neck would be. But if I want him looking up, I'm now going to have to bend my wire out. See that? There we go, like so. And then we can use that ledge to keep his chin in place as we're moulding. So the first thing we're going to do is get rid of all our lines. So we're going to blend our lines. On the nose, you don't blend all the way down, because this is a natural crease that we all have. If when you're doing this you're thinking, oh gosh, I'm not sure about the shape, I don't know if I need to add a bit more, do all of it first and then you can start looking at it, what's needed. So I've sort of taught myself this, but I can't claim full credit, like, you know, I did it without any references. I follow a lady who's wonderful called Karen Baker, and Karen actually used to live in Milton Keynes, which is where I used to live. She now lives in America, and she actually happens to have a dog which is the spitting image of my dog Ossa, who is beautiful. And Karen has done some free, well, not free, she's done tutorials for a online craft, and what would you call it? It's a teaching forum called Curious Mondo, and I'll put the links up underneath. And Curious Mondo have various artists and craftspeople. They do everything from, you know, silversmithing, jewellery making, wire winding, model making, you name it, they've got the lot. And if you sign up to Curious Mondo, they are always streaming free classes or trials. So it's a really good way to see if you like what the artist does before you buy any of the tutorials. So what do we think? Is it a he or a she? What do you reckon? I'm quite liking the look of this one. Okay, so now we've got our basic features in place, we're going to start refining it a little bit. So where to start? So first of all, I'm just going to smooth out these lines here. We want to make sure we have as few marks in the surface of the clay at this point as we can. The eyes are going to go in more or less last, because we will be continuing to move the clay around a little bit, and if you do the eyes too soon, you'll find by the time you've finished, the eyes have moved and you can have one up here and one down there. So we leave the eyes to more or less the end. So let's go into the nose. So to start off with, I'm just going to encourage the placement of where the nostrils are going to go. So everything you do a little bit at a time. You don't go straight in making a nostril. And you see the nostrils I'm blending onto the top lip. And we're creating the, what's it called, septum, that bit in the middle. Going into the top lip. That's all I'm going to do there. And I'm going to take my flatter tool and just flatten in the top lip a little bit. So you can see by flattening this, ignoring the middle bit, because we bought all the middle bit. Okay, and we're starting to encourage a top lip in. And because the top lip is wider than the bottom lip, we're also going to push this out to the side a little bit. Don't worry about what's happening with the bottom lip. Let's just blend that in a little bit. Now, when I'm doing this myself, obviously this is for a tutorial, I could keep going for hours. And so I'm just going to show you how, without getting too carried away on the detail, or else you'll get very, very bored and it'll be a very long tutorial. I just messed that one a little bit. Now, because it's clay, it's absolutely fine, because you can cut it out, put it back in, whatever you want to do. Now you see here we've got a crease that wasn't attached properly, so I'm just going back in and make sure we've got it properly attached, and I'm just putting in a little curve for the nose here. I'll do the same on the other side. And it's just gentle, I'm not forcing anything. Make sure it's about the same. And let's just push that back. So this one's starting to look a bit, she's quite snooty looking, isn't she? Okay, so I'm quite liking the way this is starting to shape. Let's just that's better. Sometimes it's a fraction of a movement which makes all the difference. So just go really careful, really gentle. I'm a bit like a bull in a china shop. It's taken me quite a while to realise that sometimes it's quite nice to just go very gentle. So you see that tiny lift is just even that lip out again. Okay, now we're going to shape in the bottom lip. So I'm just doing a slight divide. Now the bottom lip is narrower than the top lip and tends to be in line with the side of the nose. So I'm just going to take a little bit of that out and just divide the lip and the chin a little bit more. So you see, just putting that little roll in makes a difference there. There we go. So you see, I've done exactly the same process as I did on my first one, but this one is turning me into a very different looking sort of face. I'm quite liking this one. She's definitely looking a bit snooty. So the nose, I'm going to exaggerate that. And if we look to the side, you can see where it's just coming out slightly. And so I'm going to, using my ball tool, just bring that round a little bit there. So all I'm doing here is putting in a basic shape. And we're going to do exactly the same on the other side. It's very gentle. And I'm just pulling it upwards. And then I'm rolling that down. So like we did here, by rolling it, we sort of create two parts. It's exactly what I'm doing here. Okay, you get the idea. So this would need playing around with a little bit. But I've not tried to make a turnip nose. To me, that's just kind of appeared out of what we've done. So I'm just encouraging it. Okay, so that gives us a good shape to go on with. Make sure everything's attached and blended in. So you see here we've got a little gap. Let's get rid of that. And this is very characterful. You know, that wouldn't be the shape of a normal face. It's like a caricature. The more natural you want a face to look, the less exaggerated all this will be. And you'll see on the video later on where we age one side and we have a younger side, what the differences are, and also showing you how to bring it back from being a very exaggerated shape into something that's a little bit more realistic maybe. Okay, so once you've conditioned your clay again, I'm just going to see where we've got this divot here. So I'm just going to add that onto the top. And then we'll blend that in. That's better. Now, she's turning into being an old person. So where we end up with a line like that, I'm not too worried because I'm going to give her wrinkles anyway. Just use your thumb, and again, just very gently pat it down. And once you're starting to get it patted in, then we can blend it. So you can blend it using your tool or using your thumb. So and when you're blending something in a different area, you've got to be really careful and really mindful that you don't squish all your good work that you've done earlier, which is easy to do. There, so even though that's not a perfect blend, I'm not worrying about that at the moment. Okay. And always keep checking your profile. So where we've put that in, that's now starting to lift up a bit too much. So let's just square that off a little bit again. There we go. Now you see I've just squished her chin. Okay, there we go. So we've got basic shaping. So remember, we did the brow first, then we did the nose, top lip, bottom lip, and then we added in the cheeks, and then we started going back over the nose and adding in nostrils and a bit of detailing. And then we split, we decided how the lips had to be, whether they were thin or thick, and then we split this bottom piece and we just rolled it to form a bottom lip and a chin. Okay. So now let's talk eyes. So I'm just going to put her to one side. And this is my bag of eyes. And I'm still playing around with eyes. So let me show you what you can buy. So I have here some glass eyes. These ones I bought in the UK, I think off eBay, for about £7 a pair. The glass eyes are beautiful because they really do shine and sparkle, and they really do give your model life. So they are lovely to use. This is another pair of glass eyes. These came from Germany, and these were about £11. You see, and they're fully round, and they've got a little glass tail, which can be helpful as long as it goes in the right place. Because once you actually push that into your foil, if they go squiffy, you can't get them back, so they can be quite tricky to work with. So there's the two that you can buy. Now, I've watched lots of tutorials, and also from my cake decorating days. I bought this when I was cake decorating, and this came with some transfers, so flat pictures of irises. And so these have been made using resin. You can see I've got a big bubble in there, I don't know if you can see that. So you pour a little bit of clear resin into your wells, you put the transfer in, let it all dry off, and then you go in, and I've used clay, white clay on the outside, or you could use white resin. And once they've all set out, then when you turn them out, you've got a perfect looking eye, assuming you don't have air bubbles and stuff. So I really like, you know, how these have turned out, but there are issues I've got to overcome with them. And they come in different sizes. Oh, and here's one. So here's the smaller one. I don't know if you can see this, but it went really cloudy for some reason. So I don't quite, so that might come in really handy if you're doing a character. You know, if you're doing somebody to, you know, a really old person, an old witch or something, you want it to look like she's got a cataract, or that might come in really handy. So I'm keeping it. I've watched a tutorial where you create little dips of clay, and then you put a hole in, or hole, you put, you depress it. So I think I use the ball tool, and bake them. So that's hard now. So then when you put them in to your doll, you can paint them and then add a little drop of resin or clear nail varnish to give the sparkle. So I've yet to use that one, but I've made lots ready to go. And the one that I did on my last model, so I don't know if anybody has seen this one, so let me bring her in. These were just plain white, and I put them in, and then once she was made and baked, then I painted. So the irises here are painted. And I've got clear nail varnish over the top to give it a little bit of shine. And that worked quite well. I think they were quite nice, actually. So, and they were the cheapest option. So that's eyes for you. The other thing is for us to actually mould our eyes directly into our model, which is what I'm going to show you how to do. So you're not having to bake or make or do anything else. What you do have to do, though, is once it's completed, then you have to paint. Okay, so what I'm going to do is just chisel out where I think my eyes are going to be. So this clay we've got in, I'm going to take it out for now. Now, people who are much cleverer than me could actually create the eye without having to remove any clay. And I'm sure if I had enough time, I'd probably be able to do it. But for the nature of today, I'm just going to do it, show you the easier, what I consider to be the easier way. So now let's do the other side. And what you want to do is obviously get it as close to each other as possible. Because if it's wonky now, it's going to be difficult to recover later on. So let's have a look and see. Sometimes it's easier to see if it's even upside down, so you're not looking at a face, you're purely looking at the shapes. So to me, they're fairly even. If I look at the centre of the eye, it's the corner of the mouth on both sides. And that is what, exactly what we want it to be. Okay. So from here, all I'm going to do is create two little balls of clay. Now, people who are older tend to have their eyes sunk further back into their heads. People who are young and vibrant, their eyes tend to be slightly more forward. And it is minute. So, you know, let's not get too carried away with that one. Is it just slightly too big? And what you do want to make sure is that these look about the same size. So I'm just going to take a tiny, tiny bit off of one. Now, because the eyes give your model its soul, this is really worth taking a bit of time over. Okay, so if you're happy with them, what we're going to do is we're going to place one eye in there. One eye in there. And the nice thing about, like, can you see already that one already looks bigger? So I'm going to take a little bit off of this. Make sure there's no creases showing on the surface of your eyeball. That's better. So there's the eyes. Like so. And now what we're going to do is we're going to put eyelids on. And to do this, warm up a little bit of clay, and then we're just going to roll it, get a nice little pointy end on, get one of your tools, and we're going to place the pointy end by the nose, and then place the other end towards the outside. Like so. And do exactly the same for the other eye. So pointy end on the inside. And we want to try and match the angle of our eyelids. Now, people don't have exactly the same, you know, their faces aren't completely symmetrical. But we do want it. Okay, that's better. And then let's just take that one out there. Okay, and then we're going to do a very, very thin bit with a pointy end again, but not as thick as the top. This is going to become our bottom lid. So again, start placing it in a corner, and then we're just going to finish that underneath the lid. Don't worry too much if it pops up. And again on the other side, exactly the same. And take that out. So we can see our eyelids. And all we're going to do now you can do this a couple of different ways. So you can go in really gently, and it's best to go in gentle, because as you start to attach it, you can just maneuver it slightly. And you need to make sure that they look exactly the same, as best you can anyway. So I'm just very gently. And you can see where in the very, very, very corners, we've got shadow, we've got depth, where it looks like you could almost go into it. And if we can, we want to keep that. because that's exactly what our eyes do. So I just need to... Okay. And so now I'm going to use my flat tool and I'm just going to push that in so it just attaches to the top lid, like so. So it's a very gentle movement. There we go, like so. And if you need to, because this helps you to smooth out where my thumb can't get in here now. So I can just use this to add a wee bit of texture. Okay, so I would work on these for quite a long time. Now, what I need to show you. So, if this is going to be an older person, these brows will drop right over, like so. And we'd have some wrinkles in here. And that would be lifted a bit more. We also have less flesh underneath the eye. Like so. And again, we'd have more lines, and they almost cross-hatch slightly here. So hopefully you can see they look a bit older and they look a little bit younger. Okay. And so again, if you want to open the mouth, we can just lift the lip a little bit. You'll find all lips have this little loop in the middle. And that's what gives it a little bit of life. And once you've got your lip as you want it, then you can start cutting in. But you cut in towards the top. Don't cut in towards the bottom. Okay. So, hopefully this has given you some ideas for having a play yourself. You can see if I was going to be doing this now, I would be spending a lot of time refining, adding some shading, detail, depth, like so. Okay, so where we've now done our face, for example, so I'm going to keep this one a younger, happier face, smoother. And we can see we can put the same smile in both of them, but the skin here is going to be more soft, more relaxed. And you probably find you had a bit more in the way of just some extra creasing, like so. If you can see this. And I mean, I'm doing it in isolation, but actually what you need to do is do it all over. Just make all the lines a little bit more exaggerated, a bit deeper. So you can see the more lines we put in this, the more animated it looks, the better it looks from an age perspective. Okay, so ears. I love doing ears. I don't think I'm very good at doing ears. Some people are very detailed and will do the anatomical correct ear. I don't. So let me show you what I do. So like we did for the cheeks, because we're doing two at the same time, so we're going to condition our clay and then take it more or less in the middle. So we end up with two similar size pieces and we want a teardrop shape. If we're going to do elf ears end up with a nice big lump of clay at the base that we flatten out, and then the pointy ears, pointy tips. I like to stick them to my thumbs like this because then I can move them and place them, and I always place them together to make sure that when I put them on they look okay. They're going to go level with the eye but to the side of the head. So if you look at the side here, I'm actually placing the ear about here. So it's in between, it's the middle from front to back, more or less, and the same on the other side. Now, depending what you want your elf to look like, so we could have Dobby style, so it's down. If you want them to look angry, you can have them back. You can have them up and anchored over. And they all give you a slightly different character. So I think for this one, we're just going to go for a bit of a slightly out. If you're putting hair on, exaggerate your ears because the hair soon covers them up. If you're not putting hair on, then have the ears how you like them, you know, as you put them on. And so, to attach your ears, using your pressing tool, we're just going to press in the front. So that's attached there. And then we're going to go to behind the ear, and we're going to attach from there. Don't worry if it's not too smooth looking at the minute. The important thing is to get some clay and pinch it on. Okay? And we do the same on the other side. and then we're going to do the back. And what we want to make sure is that this attaches. Now, polymer clay can be quite brittle, and so you need to make sure that it's attached well. Once you've got it attached, place your ears as you like them. And then we're going to take a ball tool or your darning needle, and we're just going to very gently start marking out the ear. So if that was the lobe there, and that comes up, this is going to be the entrance. So I'm just placing a bit more pressure here, just to help creating that look of that cavity. Now, if you need to, you can use your finger to support the ear as you start to go into it. And like I say, I don't do anatomically correct ears. For me, the important thing is that we have texture. Like so. And you can see just in the shaping it out, I've now got a bit of interest. So rather than it just be a straight point, this fleshy bit has sort of come out. So I've got a bit of a wave going on, and I like that. So I'm going to do that a little bit more. So, you know, you don't plan for all of these things, but if you notice something that you quite like, then you can bring it out a little bit more. And then just pinch the tip in. So, have a play. And this one being a slightly younger ear. So again, like we did, exactly the same. The lobe is going to be a little bit fleshier and a little bit more pert. So I'm just going to support that ear a little bit more. So, I'm quite liking those. Okay, so that's the basic of doing a face. If we put a little bit more line in there, a little bit more skin pull. And you can see we're starting to layer up that age a little bit. And I'm doing this off the top of my head, but if I was doing this for an actual character, I'd have picture references to look at and to copy. Okay, now if you want to do a really pretty fairy, what you're going to do is not exaggerate everything so much. So let's just see if I can show you on this side. So the lips are not too bad. We're going to flesh those out a little bit more pert, like so. and the nose is going to be daintier. So I don't know if I can do a half and half here, but let's see. So we're going to bring that nose in, and it might be she still has a nice little button nose. So I'm just using a scalpel blade here, and I find it much easier to use the blade on its own. Her nostrils are not going to be anywhere near as big, so let's just dainty them down a little bit. So it's all exactly the same process. I would still add on the clay. So we've got a bit more of a button nose here. Fleshy lips. Cheeks. Now we're not going to be quite so characterful, so we're going to slim these right down from under the eye. And we're just going to take a little bit off at a time, because we can always add it on. Use my finger to smooth it all out a little bit. And for a very young, thin, beautiful fairy, we want a really good sense of a jawline. So I would do exactly like I did. I'd put on two pieces of clay, but I would just shape this in a little bit more. So her face is looking a lot younger. Her eyes need to be opened out a little bit. Never done anything like this before. This is quite strange, doing a half and half. And her eyes would be much more open. So let's see if we can encourage a brighter eye. So the brow would be much stronger. So hopefully you get an idea of having a younger face with having an older face. The difference on the brow lines makes a big difference, the nose and where the cheeks and the jowls go. So this one's quite high, and this one's quite low. Okay. And then the neck. Now we can see we've got a slightly odd shape because I've been resting it on the box. And at this point I'm just going to bend my wire slightly. And then only once you've decided you're happy with your face, add a bit of clay for the neck. Make sure it all blends through. And then add to that. I'm not going to add any more. And then what you're going to do is make sure you blend it well underneath. Now when you do painting and shading of your faces, again, this can be hid quite nicely. There we go. So that's the oddest thing I think I've ever created. But hopefully that gives you some ideas of creating an old elf, a characterful elf, and then a young elf. And this side, if you want to go pretty, is how I would focus it. And it's just about refining the shape and the eyes.